Blackstone Audio presents Dracula's Children by Richard Lortz. For Ramon, Child of the Night. Sometimes I feel like giving up. It is no use to fight problems. Last year when I was in the fifth grade, I tried to take the needle from some older kids in the schoolyard. I really felt that anything, even dying, was better than being here in this life. Death has to be better than this. Carmen, in Can't You Hear Me Talking to You? The First Victim. Not long after midnight, on a dark, wet morning late in July, just as the pale giant clock on the gray tower of the Greek Orthodox Church that faces Central Park West in New York City told the quarter hour through the last of the fog and the glitter of rain that slanted across its single yellow eye, a taxi careened to the flooded curb on the far side, close to one of the park entrances. It stopped so abruptly that a cascade of shining water fanned up and outward, window high, bringing an exclamation of mixed pleasure and alarm from the single passenger seated in the back. Middle-aged, pleasant-looking, tastefully dressed, she had clung to the handstrap throughout the whole of the wild, dizzying ride from the village, half the time praying, the rest just silly and giddy enough from the lingering effects of the two cocktails she'd had after the lecture, to enjoy skidding past red lights, lurching around corners, and whooshing madly through flooded intersections as if they'd had an outboard motor tied on the back. Now that the car had finally stopped, and through the misted window she glimpsed the entrance to her apartment building across the street, she breathed her relief. Yet in the next moment, laughed. The bright black eyes of the driver flicked to his rearview mirror. "What's so funny?" The tone was good-natured enough, yet edged with the kind of playful sadism that told her he was bored and that the ride had been meant to frighten or annoy her. She wouldn't give him the satisfaction of either. "Nothing. The roller coaster ride." The eyes in the mirror crinkled half shut, and she knew he was grinning. "More like Venice." He peered from his window at the lake that surrounded them. "Can't let you out on this side. How's yours?" She rolled down the window and looked, her eyeglasses instantly clouding. Through the misty haze, she saw a vast pool of ankle-deep water. Did it really matter? "I'm soaked to the knees anyway." But the driver did puzzle her. "Why don't you swing to the other side? The building with the green canopy, that's mine." The driver pointed behind them, and what she saw was little more than a blur, but obviously a white and blue police car parked opposite at the far corner. "I know the bastards. They'd give me a ticket, sure. Tell you what, I'll drive you around the block and come up legal-like on the other side." "No, no." She dug blindly into her carry-all for billfold and change purse, glanced up, squinting. "I can't read your meter."
425.
Good heavens. The cabbie was busy tightening the rubber band that gathered his long dark hair into a thick snake, oily and sleek, that hung to the center of his back.
"Lady, that's what the numbers say, right there. It counts all by itself. Real smart."
"I'm not complaining, just surprised." She found a $5 bill and squeezed it into the ridiculous little go-through box in the plastic shield that separated the passenger side from the driver's. "Does this really help?" Tapping the worn, stained wall of plastic. No answer. "Well, no one can hold a gun to your head or blow poison darts into the back of your neck." The silly man was pretending to have trouble finding adequate change in a cigar box that was obviously overflowing with it. "Keep it, and this too. A quarter and a dime. A night like this?" She gathered up her belongings. Carry-all, briefcase, two books, a bound stack of mimeographed sheets and drawings from the lecture. What else? Something was missing. Her folding umbrella. But that had been ripped from her hands the moment she'd stepped from the new school into that fearful wind, hurtling aloft like a demonic kite to melt into the writhing sea of fog and blackness that should have been Fifth Avenue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.